slave trade between Africa and Brazil, capoeira was the fighting art of revolt and escape from slavery. Brazilian slaves began to disguise capoeira as a dance, so that they could practice without fear of discovery and punishment. The spirit of capoeira is the spirit of the trickster, playful, sly, and dangerous.
I was 16, 17 years old, and it was my sister's boyfriend who at the time was training capoeira. So we were all skaters and rollerbladers, and he taught me how to rollerblade, and he started training capoeira with a group of Rabo de Haraya, regional, old school. And he opened his own little school and a gym in south of Spain. And there were like, I don't know, 50 to 80 people, topless, jingo, all together. It all started, I was playing capoeira in a beach in Goa, India. And I met this English young man playing capoeira. And it was our friend Joe, and we started playing capoeira on the beach and throwing sand at each other and throwing quechadas, and we had good fun and became friends. And we started teaching slum children in Mapsa. We held workshops for the children in Mapsa, teaching them a bit of capoeira. And Joe and I became very good friends. I remember at the end of the season, he came over to me and gave me one of his birimbaos, which is the significant instrument of capoeira that holds the roda and gives the rhythm. And that was a very powerful present to have received from a friend that you've met a few months ago and you've been a whole adventure through.
At the time that I found it, I was, I think, about 30 years old. And it was really exciting. At a time, it was quite isolating for me. I'd been a single mum for a couple of years, and so the original thing that got me was this vibrant group of people, and they were always there on a Wednesday and a Friday, and so I needed to timetable my fun at that time in my life. We had this hardcore group, as you will remember, Stan, who were just diehard. They were like, you know, we boiled it down to sort of maybe a smaller group, about six or seven, who came really regularly. It felt like a really lovely way to share capoeira, doing little workshops, going to nurseries, doing a circle and doing some moves. And the kids were so comfortable coming into the circle. They just seemed to feel at one with that kind of ritual of, yeah, in my turn, I'm going to come in, I'm going to mirror some of these moves and get into the movement and then go and sit down. And so it lent itself really well to the child's world. Disintegrated, actually, because it was a little bit intangible why it was hard for me just to throw myself into another group that had amazing moves and really good teachers.
I would have to say we've got a few really good players in Brighton, and we are super blessed with our teacher Boneco. I have always said he is the my most favorite physical artists in Brighton. His abilities are just so beautiful to watch. He's a mixture of a monkey and a kung fu artist. He can throw himself backwards and land in any kind of position, super flexible. Great player, and great joy for the game, and despite all the noise, when I get to play with Boneco, generally we're laughing. When somebody gets caught out or tripped over, or it's a game that stimulates that sort of laughter between each other, and that's what I'm always looking for, that joy of playing. And if I get caught out, I gotta laugh. That's what I enjoy, and I think that's really what sticks out with our school, that we have this fantastic teacher, and he really stimulates that with us. And then we've got another awesome player like Joe, who's played for many years as well, and has got very strong and beautiful capoeira, great teaching as well. Again, Legado, he's a fantastic player, also very dedicated to the art, very beautiful voice. And somebody who really must be mentioned is Joanna, who is Boneco's wife. And she's played also for many years, has got a very beautiful capoeira, very good singing. And these are really strong pillars in our school.
How did you get into capoeira?
Through my brother, Zangado. He was the first one in the house, in our family, to start capoeira. That was back in Brazil, in an area called Alvaroen. And I was 7 years old, a kid. And as a young brother, you always want to, you know, to kind of imitate or do what your older brother does. My brother's teacher at the time said, "Who's that little brother, the little guy standing by the door?" And my brother looked back, and it was me there. I actually started teaching right in my first year here, was in 2001.
Oh, the year I was born.
There you go. The first day, the first year, anyway, I think the first time was in 2001. I started, put my feet in Brighton. So, and then in 2007 moved, they say, Joanne and my wife, let's do it, let's move to Brighton. Because this is a fantastic place. And the capoeira here was happening, everybody was into it, loving it. First time I organized a capoeira event in Brighton. Here I have Meshali Mia and Guara, two like giants, because they're very tall guys, playing capoeira. I remember watching and they singing to each other, like challenging, like MCs, and like singing to each other like that, almost like you're like singing, you know, like that corridos, and then they play like really tough and hash the big giants, like da da. And that was, for me, it was like experience. I was like, my God, this is happening. Like, I was not happy, I was like scared, and I was, well, no, I was like this. We had a hot in the party, and for some reason, I had only one beer. Only one beer. And I managed to play everybody the next day, like, as if nothing hadn't happened the day before. I was like, up for the game, like, very energetic and stuff. And everybody, like, how can you do it? You were just dancing until 6 in the morning.
I really love the closing. I don't really know if it's a uniquely a closing song, but I just love the melody. Adeus, povo bom, adeus. Adeus, eu já vou-me embora. Pelas ondas do mar eu vim. Pelas ondas do mar eu vou-me embora. And then the chorus repeats this, which is very powerful when everybody sings that back at you. It says, goodbye, good people, goodbye. I'm on my way. Over the waves of the sea I came, and over the waves of the sea I will go again. Hey, my dear, my dear.
Marcelo Finkel. He always sings in a melody, which is something like this. Here we go. Try to remember one of the ladainha with the melody. Okay. Here we go. Lá no céu tem três estrelas. Lá no céu tem três estrelas, meu bem, todas três em carreirinha. Uma é minha, outra é tua. Ô, meu bem, a outra fica sozinha. Camará, te viva, meu Deus.
Have you ever thought about releasing an album?
No. Well, everybody thinks, isn't it? Everybody would love to.
I asked Denny the same question, and I can already guess what your answer is going to be, but what's your favourite instrument of the bateria?
Birimbau.
Yeah.
Alright.
Agogô.
Alright, heco.
No.
Birimbau is the one.
I do remember one of the myths around the birimbau. I can't remember the detail of it, but Ed used to tell it, and it was some tribe who were in trouble, they were being attacked, and they got the birimbau out and made some like amazing noises that just completely spooked their aggressor, and it was like that they'd created some magic that was too scary for whoever was coming and causing grief, and they ran away. And so I liked that, and it was about a woman as well. I think a woman playing the birimbau.
Do you know what kind of wood it's made out of?
Massaranduba. Massaranduba is in Bahia, Brazil. Yeah. So, but in the jungle in Bahia, it depends where you are, you find lots of massaranduba. Oh yeah, there's a song. Madeira de massaranduba, madeira de another one, jacaranda. So there's a song about birimbaus, kind of, you know, type of wood.
As we all know, capoeira originates, it was kind of really created into capoeira in Brazil.
Sur la plage. Là-bas, avec un orchestre de berimbau, petite formation musicale.
And some of the dances and the moves already happened in Africa, and it kind of converted itself as so many different cultures and people coexisted together on the farms, in prisons, in barns. They started playing. Many of them weren't allowed to train martial arts because they were slaves, but they were allowed to pray and to sing and to dance and to create circles to do these sort of expressions. And within those realms where the slave owners or the guards wouldn't really get too involved, they could then start training a offensive move out of the rhythm of the dance. Suddenly there was a kick, or there was a headbutt, or there was an elbow. And there are loads of different sort of melting pots from how it developed. So it's a bit anarchistic in that sense, how it became, and you'll find lots of different styles as a consequence of that. A lot of the movements, I think, then also were then picked out from their day-to-day labor, when you were cutting grass or lifting boxes or pulling out fishing nets from the sea.
My mum saw music in the park near where we lived, and she thought it's something to keep me and my brothers occupied rather than a, she didn't like the sort of karate or anything too aggressive, so she thought a good way of us to use our energy up was to get involved in this. I grew up on the Gold Coast, so for Australia it was something a bit different, and always something different to bring to a talent quest.
My story, it's one of those ones where you sort of like laugh a little bit, because my first experience of capoeira was the old crazy film that few have seen now called Only the Strong. So it's the classic Hollywood movie type movie from sort of the 1980s, I think it was from. But the first song I heard, which is the Paranawe song, anytime I hear that now, I just get goosebumps. It's like I can feel it in my bag and everything. So it's that instant connection for me, I think, in the music. And then I lived in Mexico for 20 years ago now, completely unrelated, working in scuba, teaching scuba diving. And there was a nightclub in Playa del Carmen called Capitan Tutix, which is where everyone went, and you were like the tourists, the locals, where you worked, and it was where you went to party, have a few beers, and then they would stop the music. And two people up on stage would do like a little performance. I'm standing there going, had a few drinks, so you just sort of think, oh, what's this? And I was like, this is that thing that I watched in the movie years ago.
What do you find that there's something about extra capoeira that makes it stand out?
I think it is still the I want to say more relaxed style.
Very slow. It's Devon. I mean, that's why we live in the West Country anyway. That's why you live down there. It's sort of, you live there because you want a different pace of life. I have friends in Chichester, a friend who lives in Liverpool, and it's great to go and visit. Wouldn't like to live there, it's crazy. What would unfortunately happen in Exeter a lot is we'd get someone like yourself, or I remember a Brazilian Michelle, or a Brazilian Echipo, and a girl from Slovenia, I think she was from Czech Republic. So they would come along, but they would never all come at the same time.
I mean, yeah, James is a huge part of the Exeter group, and always will be. Yeah, he sort of kept the foundations and he kept the group going. He was the glue, I guess, and he's managed to sort of churn off glue for other people to keep it going as well.
I know for me, I've had people I've played against in Ojada who have really beaten me up and put me on my bum, like your sister Helena and Mr. Fubuya, you know.
You know when the person, or you feel when the person wants to really and really attack you to hurt you, or sometimes still in the same direction, or sometimes you know when the person wants to test you without hurting you.
Capoeira, and sort of only doing capoeira for maybe 2 years to maybe 3 years. I went to Salvador and I was amazing. I mean, I was sort of, because I was part of Angoleros de Mar, and that's where they're from, people who I didn't know accepted me as a friend immediately, accepted me as part of the family.
People come, people all over the place come. I'm not just talking about Angola people, Angoles that we say, but people from contemporary capoeira, regional capoeira, they turn up in London. In Europe, I find probably that it's a very hard way, very difficult to have that, what's the one side? It's not easy, that's my point. So going through in Europe, traveling, I usually get people to say, no, it's just this hall is just us. This event is just our few friends who comes. So basically it's very limited in terms of engagement, inclusiveness. Whereas London and England, so I suppose, I think in the whole England, capoeira, I'm very, very much more like accepted in terms of what kind of style you play, regional, contemporary, doesn't matter, come to our Angola hall. So that's happened a lot in London, and that's why I find England a kind of special place for that.
This practice is fun, it calls your attention, but the true value of it is to educate people of black life, black culture, and by attending and learning is to empower the black human and acknowledging what they've been through and giving them opportunities to establish themselves in this state of society in reflection of the disadvantages those people have had.
The history of capoeira is an evolution anyway.
I think it's always nice to film the faces of the people in the circle observing the game.
You just give me an idea for Saturday.
Fantastic! me sitting there eating popcorn. Yeah,
whoa, no, but I got. Toda num tom de marrom. Agora som de tambor, nega, por favor, tô te convidando, saravá, saravá, saravá.
There's a lot of pride as well. A lot of people just want to be good players, want to be beautiful players, want to play beautiful in front of the masters or the girlfriend, or want to show their friend that they are better than them.
Surprise. We don't do capoeira so much now, but it was just so much fun.
Spread the love, really. Sort of, it's more about kindness.
Because that is what truly capoeira has, that it affects you. Well, thank you so much for having me.
No worries, you make a very good interviewee.
I like to talk, that's what my mum always said. He definitely Isn't talks that... a lot, he doesn't say much intelligent stuff. No, but...
Cool. I think that's
happy?
Yeah, that's good.
Was it nice?
Yes.
Thank you.